boy felt an intense desire to own something. He wanted a bike for summertime so that he could go around and, you know, be with his friends and enjoy the summertime. So he felt this very intense desire to have a bicycle. Now this little boy is a Catholic, born and raised in a Catholic family. So the first thing he did was to go to his mom and ask her, "Mom, I need a bicycle." But the mom said, "This is what you have to do. Go to the room, close your eyes, and pray to God and ask Him for this desire." And so he did. He went to his room, closed his eyes, had his hands in a prayerful position, he said, "Dearest Lord Jesus, I ask and pray for a bicycle today. Amen." He opened his eyes. There was no bicycle. And so probably he thought to himself, "Probably something is lacking in my prayer." So what he did was he got his mom's iPad, click into YouTube and type in search how to pray effectively. And so he ended up watching video after video of priests saying prayer. And he noticed that, I got it all wrong. I have to have my hands wide open, I guess. So he went back to his room, closed his eyes, spread his arms wide open like this, and he said, "Dearest Lord Jesus, I pray and ask for a bicycle today. In Jesus' name. Amen." Open his eyes. You can guess. No bicycle. And so he said, "Something is lacking in my prayer. Something is not enough there." So what he did is he went back to YouTube and searched for how to pray effectively and maybe more effectively. So he stumbled upon videos of Protestants making their prayer. And he noticed something very particular about their prayer. You have to be specific and you have to claim it as if it's already within your reach. So he went back to his room, closed his eyes, arms were open like this, and he said, "Dearest Lord Jesus, I pray that today I'll be given a big blue bicycle right there, downstairs, right in front of our doorstep. In Jesus' name, Amen." Open his eyes, run downstairs, open the door, and lo and behold, there was no bicycle. Out of his desperation, he ran outside, he ran to the mom's room. Notice there an image of the Holy Mother. Got it, took it between his arms, ran outside the door, ran into the forest, and hid the Mother Mary in the middle of the forest. Went back to the house, went back to the room, closed his eyes, arms wide open, and said, "Dearest Lord Jesus, you better give me that bicycle if you still want to see your mom." Certain sense of desperation in the prayer of a kid. And I guess in some sense, we do experience that desperation. We end up grumbling and complaining because God has not granted me yet prayer. I've been asking Him for the last 5 months, for the last year, for this whole time that I've been asking Him. And so we end up grumbling and complaining. And this is what happened with the people of God in the first reading today. God took them out of Egypt from slavery. But then they have to go through 40 years in the desert. And they said to Moses, they were complaining and grumbling. They were saying, "Moses, you have promised us liberation. You have promised us fulfillment in life. promises happens, and yet we are here in the middle of the desert, hungry and thirsty. Hungry and thirsty. Brothers and sisters, I'd like to invite in reading this first reading that we have here in the book of the Exodus, I want you to read it in a different light. I'd like to invite you to read it from a spiritual journey that you yourselves undergo in your own life. I know at some point all of you, all of us, we experience this kind of desert in our lives. When at a certain point we have decided to live a former life of sinfulness, come back to God, and yet when we're trying to be good, temptation and all the suffering is just right in front of us. And it's just so difficult to change the ways that we would like to be. I would like you to think of this. For example, think of an alcoholic. I don't like you to raise your hands in case an alcoholic here, but I see your confession. But I'd like you to think of an alcoholic who one day has decided to stop drinking. Okay, let's say he has decided to stop drinking. He's in, and it's never easy to stop something that you really want, really crave for. Like every time you pass, when you're walking around the city, you see a pub or a place where you can have an access to have an alcohol, you just imagine and feel the thirst running, the alcohol running down the street, and eating, right? And I tell you, the path is not easy. And we would tell ourselves, it would have been easy to just go back to the kind of life of drinking, of merrymaking, of having fun. But no, you've made the decision of stopping. For you know that God has better plans for you. For you know that God alone could suffice your thirst for life, for love, and for happiness. Have you been talking about slavery to drinking or to too much eating, let's say? But slavery from sinfulness is something that we all share. I'd be the first person to raise my hand and to say that I'm the greatest sinner in this room. And I guess we all have a tendency to say, being judgmental, thinking negative about somebody else, she sneezes and talking about them negatively. Even if you don't want to do that, you always tell yourself, it would have been nice to just go back to that and talk about that, talk about people and their imperfections, and yet we have decided not to do so. We have chosen not to do so because we know that God has a greater plan for us. This journey towards spiritual liberation, freedom, towards spiritual happiness, and spiritual love is a difficult one. And it's a continuing process. It's a long road, but it's a slow, gradual, and continuing process. In the first reading today, what sustains people is the bread that God has given them. We call them manna. And actually, the word in itself doesn't mean anything. Because when they had the bread there, they said, what is this? And they started calling it, what is this? What is this? And this is what sustained them. For us Catholics today, believers in the New Age, what does it mean to us? What is this manna that sustains us despite and in spite of the difficulty of being good and being a good believer? It is the Eucharist. It is in that prayer of the Our Father that we say, give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily rice. Give us this day our daily apple. Give us this day our daily aloe. Give us this day our, our daily happiness. Give us this day our daily freedom. Give us this day our daily love. And who alone can give that? The gospel tells us today. And they said, Lord Jesus, give us this bread from heaven. And he says, this is not a thing, this is a song. I am the bread of heaven. I alone can fill your hopes, can fill your dreams, can fill your happiness, can fill you with your love. It is this man that sustains us. You know, in our contemporary times, what makes it more difficult is that we all have this daily something, daily money, daily you have to pay them. Money that you have to earn for your family, for sustenance. A new car that we all desire, a new house, a new iPhone, the latest brand, the latest phone, a new fashion line that we all want to have. And yet, when we desire one thing, we end up desiring one. And it's just because human beings are insatiable. We're never satisfied with whatever we have there. It is because of this, for God has created us in His image and likeness, and nothing in this world could ever satisfy us. For it is only God alone suffices. Only God alone is enough. So the prayer of Teresa of Avila goes on. Whoever has God in his heart shall never lack anything. God alone is enough.